Hi everybody, my name is Colin Vonovac and welcome to our fireside chat, What's Next? This What's Next session, I will host my dear friend and our dear partner, Piotr van Schothorst. We are very glad to have you here, Piotr, to hear about your thoughts, your opinions, your remarks on how can we make society a better and more sustainable as we go. As we start, could you please introduce yourself, but also tell us a bit about your entrepreneurial journey and how did you start with investing?
Okay, thanks for inviting me. Very happy to be here. So for me, the journey started at high school, a long time ago, in the 70s. I was very interested in the concept of clean energy in the form of nuclear fusion at the time. That was it, like a new type of energy that came up, and I read about it at high school. I was fascinated about this whole concept of having like eternal energy, you know, without pollution, and without needing any oil or gas, without any fumes. So I thought, okay, I want to work in that area. And that was one of the drivers for me to start to study physics. I wasn't very good initially at physics at school, but when I learned, okay, but you need to be really good at physics and at mathematics, I started to really dive into it. So I got high enough notes to be accepted at Delft University of Technology in the Netherlands. And that's where at physics university, I found out that nuclear fusion, yes, it's all very good and dandy, but it's at least 30 years away from commercialization. So I thought, okay, well, that's a bit long. I don't want to be a researcher for 30 years and then only be part of this commercialization effort. Let's do something else in the meantime. I also has like entrepreneurial mindset. I was driving businesses to pay for my own studies. I was sort of trading in sort of costumes for university parties, them here in Amsterdam and selling them at the double price at Delft. So just to pay for my own studies. So I did other things, and I was like, I felt like this entrepreneurial concept is also very attractive. I want to pursue something. And also in the 80s, the software PCs came up, you know, Microsoft came up, Apple, and that was all fascinating stories about Bill Gates and all the others that made such sort of fantastic success, similar to what we now see more recently in the whole internet industry. So this concept of starting a small company, we're doing something innovative, disruptive, and then building it out to a massive global success, that was really appealing to me as well. Okay, but in the 80s, things were not so well organized for startups. It was not so easy to start a company.
It was not formatted, right? It was still quite...
It was something that was happening in Silicon Valley. So initially, I wanted to go to Silicon Valley. But as a Dutch guy, you know, that nobody knows, it was very difficult to sort of get access, to go there, to get a green card, and all these kind of things were very difficult. So I thought, okay, what's my next best option then? Well, let's first make some money, save some money, get some business experience, join an energy company, which is a big energy company in the Netherlands, that's Shell. So I was happy enough that Shell hired me and allowed me to work on innovation all the time. So introducing external innovation into the mainstream business. So that's one way of get to know also external startups, like these startups bring in the innovation, and I was helping them to get the feet on the ground. So that was a good lesson, but still after a couple of years at Shell, I thought like, okay, yes, I still want to be an entrepreneur, but I still don't have a very good idea of what it is that I want to pursue. This whole clean energy, it wasn't really around yet. There was no real opportunity. So I accepted another assignment in another country in Southeast Asia, which was really nice. And then another one back home in Shell Research. And that was in the late 90s when the internet was coming up. Like a fantastic innovation, of course, the internet. And it offered lots of opportunities for startups as well. But in the late 90s, it was also becoming clear that a bubble was being created overvaluation of these startups. You know, they did not make any money, but still they were valued at billions of dollars, yeah, similar to what we see now again. But that was also late 90s. So thought, okay, maybe this bubble is going to burst. And there was another thing that I was found really interesting with this 3D graphics technology. As it was also coming up, low-cost 3D graphics developed for the computer gaming business. So to make interactive 3D graphic games more sort of good looking, more high performing. And I was a gamer at the time in the evening. So I thought, could this 3D graphics technology not be used to also improve the world in some way? Because the games, in the games you were shooting people or monsters, or you're racing with cars, crashing into things. But the same technology, could it not be used for something more sort of positive, more something, you know? So that concept turned into the business of VSTEP, stands for Virtual Safety Training and Education Platform,
yeah,
to use the 3D graphics from the game
amazing
world to do safety training on, let's say, dangerous places like oil platforms, oil refineries, chemical plants, to build like replicas in 3D of those plants and allow incidents to happen and teach people how to deal with them. So that was the concept of VSTEP.
And when was that?
It was, I left Shell in the year 2000.
Wow,
and maybe
so
it was just
super...
when the dot-com bubble had bursted. Like I left maybe a couple of months too late, because then not only the dot-com sector was sort of undergoing difficulty to get funding, because all these investors were, oh yeah, yeah, we're not going to invest in these dot-coms anymore. But it was more general even. We're not going to invest in these innovative software companies anymore. They had like a bad taste from this burst of the dot-com. So when I left Shell, I didn't have any sort of, well, very little savings, not good access to investors. But in my Shell time, apart from my own idea of the safety training, I'd met some programmers. And they had another idea to use the 3D graphics for architectural visualization. So they made a product to improve to allow architects to create their own like attractive visualizations of their own designs. And that's a product later became very successful. But I was a co-founder of that company as well. I funded them, I helped them get extra funding from my colleagues from Shell. Yes. So it was very funny. So those companies developed in parallel, and VSTEP grew to like 50 people. And we developed not only like firefighter trainings, but also car driving simulators, maritime simulators. We even made a computer game called Ship Simulator, all intended to improve safety and improve training in a very safe way for people.
Yeah, but in the year 2000, that was really ahead of the market, right? Because nowadays we talk about augmented reality and artificial reality in order to do this training.
These goggles, VR. Well, there were even at that time in the late 90s, there were a couple of VR goggles from Sony. And they tried it out and decided, no, this is not a business for us. And they stopped using them. But we bought a couple of them and we managed to connect them to the computers.
And then deploy the developer position.
Yeah, deployed it for VSTEP. So we could also already at that time walk around in these game-like environments where we did oil platform training and that kind of thing. So but the trouble with the VSTEP was, there was a lot of clients for it. But no, it was not very profitable and scalable, because everybody wanted to have their own customizations, their own platform. So it was difficult to sort of scale it up in a massive way. Whereas the other company, the architecture visualization, appeared to be much more scalable. It was just one product that could be rolled out globally to all the architects in the world. So that became actually much more profitable, even though in man count, the people working there for much less people were working there. So I decided in 2017 to leave VSTEP. There were other people that wanted to take it over and bring in their sons and, you know, to make it like a family business and keep running it like it was. So that was fine. So they bought me out and I joined the first company, the architecture for the visualization company. But that company made so much money now that I, as a co-founder, shareholder, received dividends, and from the dividends I managed to do investments. So that's when I picked up this investment back to my old sort of interest of clean energy. So it was there in the back of my mind all the time, sort of waiting for an opportunity to happen. And all this money that came in allowed me to start investing in clean energy companies.
Yeah, that's amazing. That's amazing, and it's so interesting that your interests, right, of gaming in the evening when you're working, end up unlocking something, unlocking the possible business opportunities. And then when the technology was ready, right, we're able to connect, right? So it's something we always teach the startups to be observant around you, because sometimes we get so focused on what we do and we forget what is happening around us. And sometimes deploying a technology that is used for something completely different, like gaming or anything else, can be deployed to solve a problem somewhere completely different. So it's very inspirational what you're saying. But then on the investment, like you were saying, you invest now in sustainability and with the focus in energy. Can you tell us a bit more about your perspective on impact investing, your perspective in energy? You also invest in specific sustainable development goals. Can you walk us through your view on impact investing, sustainability, energy, SDGs?
Well, you see now, you could say it took a while for the world to wake up for this whole global warming problem. I mean, the world could have woken up a couple of decades before, and now it's getting a bit late, but it's good that it's still happening. Yeah. So you see this massive, the Paris Accord and the whole pledge of all these countries to become sort of carbon neutral in 2050 or even before. It makes it possible for a lot of new businesses to start up. There's so much to improve in terms of electricity production, electricity storage, plants turning from, let's say, heating up their processes with oil or gas, turning that into electricity or hydrogen for that matter. So there's tons and tons of opportunities for startups that are sort of working in this area of the renewable energy business.
Yeah. And can you tell us a bit more about the, because you focus on three specific SDGs, right, with your investments?
Yeah, 7, 9, and 13.
Can you tell the because of course you also have some people watching this that might not know about SDGs and why these three specific SDGs. Can you walk us about what was your thought process in selecting these specific three?
Well, it was my interest in energy and, of course, observing the world around me and the effects of global warming. That all played a role in the back of my mind. And then the United Nations defined these 17 the sustainability sort of goals. And if you read them one by one, I think, okay, which of these 17 can I make sort of some impact with my background in energy, my interest in clean energy? And that's indeed those three, the CO2 reduction, sustainable energy, and infrastructure becoming more sustainable.
Yeah, I find it very also inspiring what you said about selecting where can I actually make an impact, right? Because more often than not, we see investors, but also organizations, corporates, and of all walks of life, that take the 17 sustainable development goals and say, okay, we're going to focus on all of them. And then, okay, we're going to focus on one third like this, one third like that. And then, of course, there's amazing things that can be done, but then also it's very easy to lose focus, right? Or to dilute the resources and the capital and the energy into a lot of activities that might not per se really move the needle.
Yeah. To be honest, digging into this clean energy, I thought I knew a little bit about energy because I've worked for Shell for 12 years and studied physics. But if you dive into this topic, just this one topic.
Just this one is already
huge. It's already massive. Yeah. I keep reading scientific reports, governmental reports, all the time. I mean, every day almost, there's a new report coming on which has certain predictions on the adoption of hydrogen or the conversion of electricity into heat. Or there's so many aspects of even just clean energy.
Even if you focus in one, it already opens.
It's already very much. And what I also noticed from more sort of established venture capital companies, there's a lot of people working there with a business background, with a finance background, with a legal background. They don't understand the technology per se. So sometimes I think like, why did you invest in this company? It's clearly not going to work on a big scale. Yeah. But it could be the reason that they don't have sort of enough technology-oriented people in their investment teams, in their analysis teams, and sometimes they hire them from externally. But to be honest, I find it very rewarding that I have the background and the technology interest to be able to dive into all these things myself and do my own analysis. And whenever I get a pitch deck from a startup, I start calculating myself as well. And does it make sense what they're calculating here or not? And sometimes, even high-profile, heavily invested startups, you think like, where does this come from? I don't believe this is going to happen.
Yeah. No, but exactly. At the end of the day, it's all about focus, right? It's also what we always teach the startups. It's about starting and building something scalable and repeatable, but with a clear
absolute
focus for us as well. Yeah. And we've had this conversation, of course. We also, when we started Bootcamp Sustainability, we looked at the 17 SDGs and we had to focus. If we wanted to build a program that would be successful, first thing that we had, from the 17, what can we actually move the needle? Right. And I think this is, like you said, because if you zoom in there, it's still big, right? And if you keep it already big, it becomes so easy to just scratch the surface.
Absolutely.
And then you're not moving the needle,
To be honest, it's very tempting for me because I hate plastic waste. And I think like, I wish I could do something about that too. There's plenty of opportunities in that space as well. But I analyzed a couple of these startup pitch decks, and it takes a long time for me to really get to the bottom of it. And I think in the end of it, I really can't say. This is too big of a different area. I don't know who the market players are, what alternatives there are. Is this one really going to make it? Seaweed-based plastic alternative. Like, sounds fantastic. Or I dove into it. But then there's a lot of other sort of plastic alternatives made of even cheaper materials, like from sugar even. They make bioplastics, plastic replacements that are completely biodegradable from sugar. Fantastic. But
can this win? I don't know. Yeah.
Which is going to win? So it needs a dedicated person to only dive into this topic if you really want to sort of make investments that make sense.
Exactly. And you mentioned as well about, of course, your interest of reading reports and scientific papers and so on. What do you see are the trends looking forward in energy, in clean energy? What do you see that is going to win, but in energy, but also in the production of goods and services that capture a lot of this energy? What do you see? Of course, it's always a bit, right?
What do you see getting traction? Clear trends. That's the beauty that we have a history of, let's say, 10, 20 years now with solar, scaling it up to a big scale, and wind, offshore wind. And you see that the price of offshore wind and the price of offshore or of solar in general goes down dramatically. It's only a fraction of what it cost it even 10 years ago. It's amazing. So that brings up lots of new opportunities for countries and even the Netherlands. So, we thought, we are wind. We don't have too much sun, so we can build a couple of windmills on the onshore. But a lot of protest against it. So, we have more space offshore. So we build like offshore sort of farms of windmills, like massive farms, and they're scaling it up and they become more profitable. Yeah. Some of them don't even need subsidy anymore. And normally, anything you do that makes a change on the infrastructure requires a lot of subsidy. And wind has required a lot of subsidy in the past, but that's paying off now because of the economy of scale.
Because the market also matures to understand what it is and starts to consume more.
Exactly. Yeah. So now they're thinking of building even more wind farms, even further away from the coast, because the sort of the easy accessible areas are being reached now. So they need to move further out to the North Sea. And then it becomes maybe a little bit more expensive. So maybe some extra subsidies are needed. But in general, the price has come down to a very acceptable level. And solar, maybe not in the Netherlands, but solar in, let's say, sunny countries, yeah, is by far the cheapest way of creating electricity. So you could say like, oh, let's get rid of all the coal, the coal generators and all the gas-based generators. But the trouble still is that the sun only shines a couple of hours a day and not at night, and the wind not only blows. So what do you do in the sort of the periods, especially in the Northwest Europe area, where sometimes it's for weeks it doesn't blow, and in the winter time there's not much sun. So storage becomes a big part of the whole picture, and investment in different storage technologies. And so there's a lot of emphasis, if you talk about trends, about research into different technologies, into different chemical storage, into hydrogen storage. So that's another big trend, and it's going to be a big part of the whole sort of the whole future energy infrastructure picture. So I follow that trend very much as well. And it also there you see almost weekly a different report. One of them says, oh, we don't need hydrogen as long as we have very long electricity cables to other countries, you know, because when there's no energy generated in the Netherlands, there is energy generated somewhere else and they can bring it to us. So that is like one solution. But another solution could be, let's not do that and let's just focus on just creating all the electricity just for our own country, yeah, to be independent of them, because now we're relying on the gas from, in the Netherlands, we rely on the gas supply from Russia. We don't want to be dependent on Russia. Like, let's do it all, you know, in-house as much as possible. And you can make all these different sums, like what is the best sum for the Netherlands. But in the end, it appears that the total price in the different scenarios is almost the same. So it's like a strategic or even political choice which one you make. And that probably is the same for all the other countries. They all need to make their own sums and their own strategic decisions. Do we want to be like importing lots of hydrogen from, let's say, that is generated in North Africa? Or do we want to generate it with a higher price because there's less sun here and that kind of thing? Do we want to generate it over here? So you see, a big trend is the idea development in all the different countries and regions, like how do we want to be completely sustainable in terms of energy supply.
Yeah, and the impact that has then from bottom up, right? If for these specific needs that it had, and all these startups that and innovative players that start to pop up everywhere with completely new models, different models,
yeah,
that might not fly in country X, but might fly in country Y, or might not even fly on their specific geography, but might fly in a completely different geography. So bringing them together, at least having them in a radar, it's very, very powerful.